Try that again. I said, it's a beautiful morning, isn't it? You're allowed to respond to me. I'm going to have you stand. Turn to the person next to you and say, I love you. So glad to see you in God's house today. Shout of praise. Come on, let's worship him. I think it'd be good if we sing a little bit more. I know my Lord gonna leave me out. I know my Lord gonna leave me out. I'm gonna pray to the best I can. I I saw the Lord seated on the throne. And the train of his robe filled the temple. The angels gathered round, and they your hands and sing, you are holy, oh, so holy, you are holy of all. Woe is me, for I am unclean, for my eyes have seen the Holy King. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song of him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. All creation I sing. with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Of our being, we praise you and glorify you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want to go over a thought or two just real quickly before we go in further into the service. And I want everybody in the building, everybody online, and we have a lot of people that are part of this online, and we're thankful. We're thankful for each one that's here and in person, each one that's online. And matter of fact, just congregation, will you welcome our online congregation? Thank you. Thank them for being with us. In the early service, we made mention of what I'm about to say, and I wanted to say it in this service. Now, let me preface this. This is not the sermon. I just want to encourage you a little bit, and I think it's important that we do so. And those of you that are online, this is Pastor Troy Irvin on our Facebook there, and I want you to do something for me. I want you to listen to me closely. I want to make mention of what's coming this week. And on my page, I don't want you starting some kind of political debate. I won't have it. If you start that, I'll erase every bit of it. My page exists, and this church exists, to preach Christ and Him crucified. That's why we're here. That's why we're here, to preach Jesus. And I want you to listen to him. I'm asking you. I've not made a debate of things. I've not, carrying on with people and all the rest of it that a lot of the church is doing. I don't want to be a part of the divide, but I do want you to listen to me. Tuesday we're going to be voting, and it's an important day. And I will not presume to tell anybody who to vote for. That's not my job. That's between you and God. And by the way, when I go in that booth, it's just going to be me, and you're not in there with me, and I don't want to hear your clatter and clamor in my ear when I'm in there. I don't want to hear from you. I want to hear from God. I can promise you I'm not going to consult Facebook before I go on and see who's been arguing. This is going over already like a lead balloon. I want you to understand this. I want to also say that the answer for our nation is not Kamala Harris or Donald Trump. It's Jesus Christ. Amen. You hear me? It's Jesus. He's the answer. Now, having said that, the Bible, nowhere in the Bible is there voting. There's no such thing as a republic in the Bible. That doesn't exist in Scripture. I do believe that being part of a republic is the best form of government in this earth. I do believe that. And I appreciate the fact that we have the opportunity to partake and vote on people who are going to represent us. We're not a democracy. We're a republic. Someone say amen. We're not a democracy. We are a republic, and I appreciate that. And I think it's important that we, as citizens, you know, and I believe the Bible teaches us in many ways to perform our civic duties. And I want to encourage you this week to do just that and go out and vote. And I want to say just a few things in regards to what voting does. And I want you to listen to me. This is not the sermon, but this is important. Those of you that are online, I want you to listen to me. Voting does this. It gives voice to our values. It gives weight to our convictions. And voting and partaking in our civic duties can make a difference in our nation and in our world. It's one of the ways, not the only way, but it's one of the ways that we can penetrate our culture and be the light that God's called us to be. It's one of the ways that we can exercise our faith in public. It is certainly an opportunity to reflect our biblical values in our society and to promote righteousness and justice and to love our neighbors as ourselves. And I think it's important that we perform our civic duty and go out and vote. I want you to listen to me. Before you go in that little voting block, little booth, I want you to pray. I encourage you to pray that God will guide your heart and guide your decisions that you make, not just based on your own emotional drive. What does God want me to do? And what reflects the values that my Bible teaches me as a person? Because when you vote, you are in essence going into covenant with someone to represent what you believe. And they're going to go and represent the values that you reflect. Now, there's no one going to reflect perfectly what I think and believe. But it is important that you pray and ask God. And those of you online, ask God what he wants you to do. And let's pray that God's will would be done in our nation. I want to say that again. I want us to pray that God's will be done in our nation. Now, let me say a couple more things in regards to this, and then I'll preach in a few minutes. Now, listen to me. I want you to know that when it's all said and done, if we find out Tuesday night or find out a month or two later, it doesn't matter, whoever our next president is and whoever the other people that take office in our government is, whoever they are, whether it be Donald Trump or Kamala Harris or anybody else, whoever takes office, when it's all said and done, there's one thing that I can count on. I can count on the fact that Jesus is still going to be Lord. I can count on the fact that he's still our Savior. I can count on the fact that he's going to come back someday and be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And my citizenship is of another country, another world. I'm part of his. Are you hearing me? I can count on that. No matter who takes office. And whoever the president is will not change who Jesus is. Nor my responsibility as a Christian to live my life to his glory and present the gospel to this world. And I want to encourage you that no matter what happens I want you to be part of the answer, and let's try to bring healing to our nation, no matter who takes office. Reach out to people, love people, no matter what. Somebody say amen. Amen. And, you know, please partake in this, participate, ask God to guide you and help you in the decision that you make. That's what I'm going to be doing. I'm going to pray, and I'm saying, God, you tell me, you show me what your will is and what I need to do in this voting booth today. You speak to my heart, and I will do what best reflects you. I encourage you to do the same. I encourage you. Now, I don't want you coming up to me arguing with me. I don't want you to ask me who I'm voting for, because it ain't none of your business. I'm not going to tell you what to do. You don't tell me what to do. Let's do what God says to do. Amen? So I'm not going to argue with him. Don't you start no arguments on my Facebook. I'll kick you off. I'm here to preach Jesus. That's enough said about that. I wanted to mention it today, though, because I believe it's important that we get involved. Doing nothing does nothing. Let me say that again. Doing nothing does nothing. All right. Ushers, I want you to come. I wanted to say that before I received the offering. And we're going to receive the offering. I hope that didn't affect your tithing. Maybe I should have waited till after the offering. Huh? Are you here with me still? Are you still in the room? Good, good. Father, bless this offering. Multiply it for your glory and use. And God, I pray that you'll be with us. May each and every one of us seek your face. May each and every one of us look to you. May we know what you want us to do when we perform our duties as citizens. When we vote Tuesday, God, help us to vote in accordance to your will and in accordance to your word. Help us, God, to stand firm on our own values that you've given us and the morals that come from your truth. Help us, I pray, to do that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I don't think I'm on. I'm good now? All right. Can you turn me up? That would help. How about that? All right. I want you to turn in your Bible this morning to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1. I'm going to have you stand, please, and let us reverence the Word of God as it is read. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your word. We believe, God, that you're going to speak to us very clearly today, very concisely, and I ask that each of us will have ears to hear what the Holy Spirit has to say. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to go ahead and have you a little bit more, please. Thank you. Beginning today and over the next few weeks, I'm going to be dealing with the topic, the Lamb. John the Baptist, waist deep in water, baptizing men unto repentance. And along come Jesus. John took the attention off of himself and pointed to the shore. Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Behold the Lamb. The purpose of the Lamb was to take away sin. What does he do with our sin, preacher? Well, the psalmist said, he cast them as far as the east is from the west. The prophet Isaiah in chapter 1 and verse 18 declared that he makes them white. And in 38 and verse 17, he says that he puts them behind his back. And in chapter 55, that God pardons our sins. Micah said that he cast them into the depths of the sea. And the Hebrew writer told us that God remembers our sin no more. The purpose of the Lamb was to take away our sins. The power of the Lamb is found in His blood. Peter said, we're not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold or the vain conversations or traditions of our fathers, but we have been redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, without spot nor blemish, slain from the foundations of the earth. There is yet power in the blood of Jesus Christ. Power that cleanses, power that covers. And we can rejoice this morning knowing that the power of the Lamb was shed by His blood. And the most powerful thing in this world is the blood of Jesus Christ. But here's what I want to deal with over the next few weeks. And I find it interesting how God always unfolds things and reveals things progressively. I want to talk about the process of the Lamb. The process of the Lamb. In Genesis chapter 4, we find that it was a lamb first. It's as if God says, I'm going to start on square one and communicate that it will be a lamb for man. You remember the Bible says that Adam knew his wife Eve, and she bore a son and named him Cain. little later, they were intimate, and he knew his wife, and she bore another son, Abel. And in the process of time, it was time for them to do what they had been taught by example from their parents. It was time for them to bring a sacrifice to God. It was time for them to individually approach God and come to God. And by the way, you and I can't come to God because someone else. We can only come on our own. We can't be saved because mom was saved or dad was saved or grandma or grandpa served God. No, it is a personal relationship that we have with God. It was time for them to present a sacrifice. Now, let me tell you this. You can't approach God with anything less than sacrifice. We can't come to God with anything less than sacrifice. And not just sacrifice, but a specific kind of sacrifice. For it says that Cain, he was a tiller of the ground, and he was a good gardener. I would imagine his garden was pristine, and the fruit that it would yield was bumper crop every time. I can imagine there wasn't a weed growing between any of the fruit that was being produced in that garden. He was a good tiller of the ground. And the Bible says that he brought of his first fruit of the garden and sacrificed it, brought it to God. And God didn't have respect for that. He said, no, I don't accept that. Abel brought of his firstlings a lamb and spilled the blood and presented a blood sacrifice to God. And God said, I have respect for that. I accept that sacrifice. Cain was rejected. Abel accepted. Cain, no respect. Abel, he respected. Cain came to God from a humanistic standpoint. I know the route. I know what I'm supposed to do. But I think God will understand if I do it my way. I've heard people say things like that. Now you listen to me. You and I don't come to God on our terms. We come to God on His terms. We don't do things our way and expect God to accept it. No, we have to do things God's way. God said, I don't accept this humanistic religion. Religion is somehow man trying to get to God and do it his way. Make great sacrifice. And you can make great sacrifice and still find no relationship and no worship with God. There's only one route. And God said, I don't accept that. I reject that. And Cain knew what he was supposed to do. Abel brought the lamb. And there was a blood sacrifice, and God accepted that and found worship with Abel. They knew what to do. They had seen their parents. Obviously, Adam and Eve, they had sacrificed and worshiped God. And you know where they learned it. They learned how to worship God from God Himself. Remember when they sinned in the garden and ate of the fruit that God said not to eat of? You remember what happened. God said, you'll die. But standing there in the presence of God with the fig leaves tied around them, God kind of laughed at that whole idea that we can cover our own sin, we can make our own way, we can do it ourselves. I covered my nakedness. I went to JCPenney and bought a suit. I wore it this morning. No. God said, come with me. And they went to the backside of the garden. There were two animals that had been slain and that been skinned, and there were two coats of fur, and God put those coats around Adam and Eve with the blood still dripping off the bottom of them. And he covered them. And all these years later, the blood of Jesus still covers us. Somebody else say amen. Amen. And they had watched their mother and their family make sacrifice to God. And Abel knew to bring a blood sacrifice. And Cain knew, but Cain said, I'll do it my way. Now listen, through the years I've heard so much debate. I have read so many people and all the different things they try to put in here and figure out why God rejected Cain and accepted Abel. I've heard everything under the sun that he didn't bring the right. I mean, I've heard every kind of argument and different things that people say about this and their ideas, and I've heard the prosperity preachers make money out of it. I've heard it all. But it's real simple and it's real clear. The Hebrew writer would tell us the answer thousands of years later when he said, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. It takes the blood. Reminds me of my sister Kathy and her friend. When they went to college, her friend Joy. They were in class, and it was Bible college, and they got on Genesis chapter 4, and they were debating back and forth and back and forth and arguing and all the different things about, you know, what could this mean and why did God reject Cain? And finally, Joy raised her hand. They said, what's the answer? She said, well, here's the bottom line. God didn't accept Cain. Why? Because you can't get blood out of a turnip. I thought that was pretty good. Now, I borrowed that from Joy, and I gave her credit. The second time I say it, I'm going to say I've heard said. And by the third time, I'm going to say I've always said this. No, you can't get blood out of a turnip. It's real simple what's happening here. God would only accept a blood sacrifice. And you and I can't approach God outside of the blood. There's only one route. It is a gory, bloody sacrifice. And God peeled back the veil and he said, here is how salvation is going to look. Here's how redemption will go. It will be a lamb. And the first thing he showed us is in Genesis chapter 4 when they brought a lamb for one man. A lamb for a man. One person. That teaches us a couple things. It teaches us the value of the individual. It shows us just how valuable you are. I have people that have talked to me at times and said, I am of little value. I'm of no value. I'm worth nothing. I'm nothing. And I say to them, that is just the furthest thing from the truth. Do you know how you give value to something? Maybe I'll try the people online. Do you know how you give value to something? You attach value to something by what someone's willing to pay for that thing. I mean, you could say your house is whatever you want to say it's worth. You could put it up for sale by owner and say, I'm selling this for $1.5 million. And the fact is, maybe your house is worth that, but mine's not. But I could say, my house is $1.5 million. I'm putting it up for sale. And you need to understand there's nobody going to give $1.5 million for my house. And if you're willing to, I'll meet you this afternoon. Let's take care of this now. Write the check now. Let's do this. No, but value. You place value on this building. How do you figure it out? They read the comps. They see what properties are going for in the area. And something that's equivalent to your property. And then they say, this is what other people, this is what they're paying for these homes or these commercial buildings or whatever it may be. And then they put the number according to what people are paying. Value is placed on something by what someone is willing to pay for it. We need to learn value. And the fact is, the reason why you are so valuable, because God said right in the beginning, they bring a sacrifice. Abel, one man, he brings a sacrifice, and God shows respect, and he loves Abel, and he honors Abel, and it's one man. And God is saying in the very beginning, in Genesis chapter 4, my plan of redemption, my plan of salvation is going to unfold, and I'll do the whole thing, and we'll go through the whole process, and we'll accomplish every bit of this process and meet every requirement if it's only one man. That's how valuable you are. He was willing to pay the blood of his own son. That's a lot of value right there. You don't get any more valuable than the blood of Christ. Silver and gold can't buy it. You can't amass. That's why Jesus asked a question one day. What is a soul worth? And what will a man give in exchange for his soul? And then he asked a bigger question. What would it profit a man if he gained the whole world and lose his soul? What would it profit if he's a multi-billionaire or a multi-trillionaire? If he sat on the pinnacle of every government and ruled and reigned the entirety of the world and had trillions of dollars at his disposal and he loses his soul, what's it worth? That's why Solomon, the richest man that ever lived, amassed amount of wealth that would make Bill Gates looked like a pauper. He was the wealthiest person that ever lived. And he looked across his kingdom and he said, it's vanity. It's vanity. There's nothing. It's empty. There's nothing to it all. Queen Elizabeth ruled a kingdom upon which the sun never set. If you've read history, you know how England colonized the world. Great Britain, they colonized the world. And when the sun would set in the east and rose up on the other, in the west, and rose up on the other side of the world, then her kingdom was there, and vice versa. Here, when the sun gets up in the morning and we see it peeking on the horizon, it was still her kingdom. She was a wealthy lady. She had dresses in her wardrobe that would run entirety of economic systems of a whole country. That's how wealthy she was. And when she was on her deathbed, the priest was reading the last rites. And she bowled up out of bed, grabbed his collar, and said, I would give all the wealth that I've amassed if I had 1 hour to get right with God. But it's too late for me. What was she saying? I've gained the world, and it's nothing. It means nothing. Beside the sightless, endless ages of an eternity where people are either in heaven or hell, it means nothing. And God says, here's how valuable you are. It is a lamb for a man. A lamb for a man. It's important to learn value. I was telling them in the early service, I'm teaching my son right now a lesson in value. Has no idea how hard it is to get stuff. He had a pretty nice car that we got him, blew the engine up in it, got him an engine, tore up the transmission, got him a transmission. A week or so later, blew up the engine. Now he says, I don't know if he's watching this today, but he says, I didn't do anything to blow that engine. Of course, the rubber on the wheel wells tell another story. Were you all 18 one time? He's 18. But that wasn't it. He doesn't even know this. The tow truck driver that brought the car to the mechanic, my friend, said, Well, the boy at college wasn't upset. He had big smiles on. He said, no big deal. And that man didn't know me. He didn't even know that I knew the mechanic that well. And he said, I guess Dad just had to buy me a new car. I said, oh, is that right? So I went out and bought him a 1999 Toyota Camry for $800. Let me teach you something about value. Come on, all the daddies in the room know what I'm talking about. Oh, you just, oh, Dad just had to buy me a car. Oh, is that right? I'll buy you one, all right. And the hood wouldn't even latch. And the guy said, you want me to get a new latch? I said, nope, bolt it down. Got bolts sticking up out of the hood. And I got to tell you, that thing runs like a champ, though. It runs great. And Alex said to me the other day, he said, now, Dad, you know, he's 18. He's in college. He said, Dad, you know, my friends, it doesn't bother me. This thing, it looked, I mean, the girls, Bella and Bailey, when I brought it home, they said, Dad, did you get it at the junkyard? Alex said the other day, he said, well, Dad, he said, it doesn't bother me too much with my friends, but man, what if I want to ask a girl out? I said, I guess we're going to find out whether you got game or not. If it takes the car, you ain't got no game, boy. That's terrible. It's just a daddy talking to his 18-year-old boy, all right? I said, you thought you were all good looking and hot stuff, huh? Maybe it was the car. Now I'm teaching him value. That things cost something. And that's the point. In the very beginning, in Genesis chapter 4, God said, I'm going to show you the value of that one man. I'll do the whole process. I'll unfold the whole thing because I love Rob. I love Katie. I love Frank. That one. Oh, that the church could remember the value. You know, churches and ministries, and I've pastored all size. I've pastored small churches, 1,500 member churches. I've pastored big, small, and everywhere in between. And all of us, it's so easy to get lost in programming. It's so easy to get lost in buildings and structures. And boy, that building was $7 million, or this one cost $500,000. We got to take care of this, and we got to take care of that. And we get lost in the swell of everything and forget the most valuable thing in this building right now is the person sitting right next to you. They're the most valuable. And if this morning, in the early service, only one person come, I'm going to get up and preach it to that one person. And in this service, if only one person had shown up, then God help us that we say, you know what? They're valuable. The whole gospel unfolded. God gave his son because he loved that person. And it doesn't matter who they are. And it doesn't matter what they've done. And it doesn't matter what color skin they are or what part of the country they're from or part of the world they're from. God loves that individual. And the gospel is for that one, that person. The value is, I'm preaching better than your amen. The value is, that's why we're here. I've never seen a day in the modern day church of so many ministries and so little ministry, so little title and so little, so big of truth and so little truth, so many titles and so little truth. I've never seen a day of so caught up in the pomp and the ceremony and the lights and the cameras and the smoke and nothing against it. Have what you want. But you get all this stuff going on and most of the church looks more like a nightclub anymore than it does even a church. And we've got lost in the entertainment and lost in the swell and lost in the business and lost in the money and lost in all the action.
God help us that we get back to the place that it's about that one, that fella that you walked by when you left the ball game, and he's the off-scouring of society, and he's got his hand clenching a brown paper bag and a sign on his chest, and we walk by like he's nothing. Jesus died for that one man, the one that we think is less than, the one that we think is nothing, the one that we think is worthless. He died for that man. The one. God help us. Man, I'm on fire with this. I'm about to take off. Hallelujah. You know why I'm on fire with it? Because I'm that one man. He peered down through the eons and the ages of time and saw a little old nobody from nowhere in Wellston, Ohio, nestled in the foothills of this state, and said, I love him, and my lamb is for him, and the blood is for him. And he ever saw fit to save me and redeem me and wash me. I'm thankful, and I never take for granted the value that God placed on me. And that's where we need to put the value. Yeah. You never know what someone's going through, the person sitting next to you, what they're facing. And you come in church and say, well, did you see Brother So-and-so? Did you see Sister So-and-so? You see, well, who was that one person? Boy, what were they wearing? Don't they know you don't dress like that when you go to church? I'm just going to sit down and say amen to myself. Is that all right? Isn't that what church folk do? Well, I can't believe they would act like that. Come looking like that. We put value as churches on numbers, size. Remember hearing a story of a pastor? The whole year went by, had one convert. He went to the district council and said to the moderator in that area, the guy, the preacher that was over that district for the denomination, and he said, I'm going to quit. I'm a failure. He said, what do you mean? He said, well, I went this whole year and only had one convert, and it was just a little boy, about 7 or 8 years old. He said, I'm just a failure. They said, oh, don't quit. But the little boy that year that was saved in that little country church, his name was Wee Bobby Moffat. Now, you don't know who Wee Bobby Moffat is, but history will tell you Wee Bobby Moffat is one of the greatest preachers that ever lived. God used him. He wrote commentaries and books, even wrote a translation of the Bible, and used him in a couple centuries ago, used him in a powerful way to spread the gospel all over the world. But the guy had placed value on the fact, I'm just going to quit because I only have one little convert. And God says, a lamb for a man. A lamb for that little boy. Let me give you another story kind of like that. It's a cold winter morning. This would have been back in the 1800s. The snow had fallen. Boy, it was deep. A lot of churches didn't even have church, but one little old country church said, we're going to go ahead and open the doors. And the preacher wasn't even there. It was just a lay preacher that showed up and was stoking up the stove. And one little boy walked in and sat there. And the lay preacher said, well, I can't even really preach. The preacher can't make it. He's stuck. I do some preaching, but I don't even know, whether I even have it or not. But he said, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and tell the gospel to this little boy. And he's just a terrible preacher, much worse than me even. He couldn't hardly put a sentence together. And he just kept saying this, look and live,
Look and live. Look and live. Where Moses had lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. And when they got bit by the fiery serpents, they could look and they would live. And it was a type of Christ. And he just kept saying, look and live. And that morning, that little boy looked and lived. You know who he grew up to be? Charles Spurgeon, the prince of preachers. Built a mega church on preaching the gospel before there were ever such things in London, Metropolitan Tabernacle. And there's not a week go by yet, hundreds of years later or more, that some preacher don't read a Spurgeon sermon getting inspiration for his message that Sunday. God used him in a powerful way. In that little church that day, the lay preacher said, look and live. And God said, a lamb for a man. A lamb for a man. Right in the offset of this thing, he said, you're important to me. You're important to me. You are valuable to me. And that's where God's at with you. It is a lamb for a man. Now, I could preach on, but I've said enough. And there's a lot more I could go into right now, but I feel the check in my spirit. That's enough. I want you to know today how valuable you are to God. He loves you. And those of you that are online, I don't care where you are, and those that will listen to this later, someone's going to watch this, and you're going to feel like you're of little value. God loves you. He looked at Abel's sacrifice, and he said, I accept that. And he'll accept you through his son, Jesus Christ. He loves you. Everybody stand with me, please. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Nobody looking but me and the Lord. And let's be reverent to the Holy Spirit as he does his office work. I wonder if there's someone here in this building this morning, or those of you that are online, that would say, I need God. I need God. Maybe you're not where you should be, and you know it. The Holy Spirit's dealing with your heart. Maybe you're away from Father's house. Maybe you've backslidden. Maybe you've never known Christ as your Savior and your Lord. And you would say, I need Jesus in my life today. No one looking, me and the Lord. Will you just slip your hand up and say, will you pray for me that I'll find him before it's too late? Slip it up quickly. Anybody like that in this place? I need Jesus. I see that. God bless you. Somebody else. I need the Lord. I need that lamb in my life. Anyone else? We tarry just a moment longer. Those of you that are online, if you need the Lord, I want to encourage you to type something there. And we'll be praying with you too. Anybody? Anybody else? Now, I promise I'll pray for you. But I'm also more than happy and willing to pray with you. Without a big drawn-out pull, I'm not even going to sing a song this morning at the altar call. I just wonder if you would say, I need a lamb for me today. A lamb for a man. A lamb for a person. I invite you to come and let Jesus Christ do a work in your heart and in your life. Anybody like that? I invite you to come and stand or kneel right here. Father, I thank you and I praise you for the faithfulness of the Holy Spirit. I thank you, God, that when your word goes forth, it always accomplishes what it's supposed to do. And Lord, I thank you for every person that's been here. As we leave this place today, I pray that you'll go with us. God, if anybody leaves that's not right, that's unsaved, I pray that you'll pester them all day. That the Holy Spirit will just deal with their heart. And this little fragmented message that I tried to put together, anointed of the Holy Spirit, will roll around in their head all day long and roll around in their spirit all day long until they steal away, maybe by a bedside or take a walk or kneel by a chair or something and say, Jesus, I ask you to be a lamb for me today. Wash me and cleanse me. Make me new. And if they'll pray that way, you'll do it in an instant. May they do that this day and then tell someone about it. Bless your children. Give us a great week as we honor and serve you. In Jesus' name. And God's people said amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.